Viewers, you are watching the Policy Times, India's only channel which talks about public policy and foreign affairs. So now when we talk about policy or public policy making, the very first factor that comes in is education. So if any country actually wants to be an economic and a real superpower, it at any cost of time cannot compromise with quality and quantity of education. And I think on this we cannot have a better person to talk and take views on than other than Professor Furqan Qamar. Professor Furqan Qamar sir is actually the Secretary General at Association of Indian Universities. Before coming here, he was also VC at a University of Himachal Pradesh. He has extensively has decades of experience in the higher education sector. Sir, thank you so much for giving time to us on this important subject. So sir, as I introduced, education is always the backbone, to take any economy, society, country to the league of superpowers or advanced economies. Given that India has always been in the background, has been struggling to be an education hub, a global education hub in this world. It is still struggling with the literacy rate, the quality of education. What is your view and take on this?
No, Akram, you have very rightly said that education and health, these are right. The two very critical factors which enables population to perform and become very useful, enlightened citizens right. of the country. And therefore, education has to be a focus. I do not know much about school education, but I know a little bit of higher education. But generally speaking, we have made good progress in the area of education. For example, now the basic education and then elementary education, these are all universal. We had launched a scheme to promote retention of the children in a school, so midday meal kind of a scheme, then making education as a right for the citizens of the country, so right to education, right. Also making it inclusive, for example, right to education also provided that all segments of the society should be provided of this opportunity. So schools closer to homes, facilities to all, in all kinds of schools. So these are all there. Coming to higher education, this sector about which I know somewhat better, even in the area of higher education, we have made tremendous progress. And I often say that there are three challenges relating to higher education. They were our challenges when we became independent. Some of these are still our challenges now. For example, our first challenge was that we are a very populous country. We are a country where people value education and higher education. People would compromise and sacrifice their necessities right. but would want their children to receive the best possible education that they can afford. So our biggest challenge was expanding the capacity of higher education, creating capacities in order to accommodate the demand for higher education right. which was there at the time of independence. Projection was that it is likely to go up. We are right that it is still increasing. So expansion was the first challenge. And on this count, India has made huge progress. For example, I always say that when we became independent, at that time, we had less than 24 universities in our country,
right.
less than 500 colleges in our country, about 2 lakhs students studying in our higher education system. So from that scenario in 1950 to a scenario where we have close to 1,000 universities,
right.
40,000 colleges and other higher educational institutions either affiliated to universities or standalone autonomous kind of an institution. We have about 36.5 million students going for higher education. So this is a huge progress. In terms of the higher educational institutions, we have become one of the single largest system of higher education found anywhere in the world. In terms of our enrollment, we have become the second largest system of higher education found anywhere in the world. The other day I was looking at data and then I found that there are only 40 countries in the world which have population equal to our enrollment in higher education. If you add enrollment in all school education, etc., so it is very, very huge. So this was the first challenge. Even in this, there may still be gap. There may still be issues that we may need to address. For example, there may be regional variations.
Right.
There may be concentration of colleges and universities in certain regions.
Absolutely.
And there may not be as many colleges and universities in the other region. So that has to be addressed. So I'm not saying that we have overcome all of these challenges. Second challenge that we had then and is now is making higher education inclusive and equitable.
Absolutely.
In the sense that the merit is not the exclusive domain of only the rich and the wealthy and the elite.
Absolutely.
Merit is everywhere. To ensure that this merit is captured and this merit is provided opportunities to further develop is a challenge for any country, but even for a country of our size, of our diversity, this is a major challenge.
Right.
Now, even on this count, we have made huge progress, I would say. For example, this 1950 data that I cited, 3 years immediately after independence, women were very scanty. They were there, but in a very, very small number, they could be counted on fingertips. Today, gender parity index is close to one.
In fact, they are performing better.
In fact, the boys and the girls in the enrollment are equal, almost equal in number. And as you said that sometimes the girls are, not sometimes, in most of the convocation that I go, I find that out of 10 medals, 7 to 8 would be going to the girl students. So we have made huge progress. Social groups, imbalances. For example, how many scheduled castes, scheduled tribes were there?
Absolutely.
Immediately after independence or at the time of independence, the number was very small. That was the reason that we had the affirmative action policy, the reservation policy provided for in our constitutions. Today, they may still not be represented in higher education in the same ratio in which they are represented in the population.
Right.
But increasingly, I am finding that their participation or their presence in higher education is close to the extent of reservation. Okay. So scheduled castes are a little more than 15% nationally. Scheduled tribes are a little higher than 7.5%. The best that can a country have is that all higher educational institutions should in fact represent the same diversity which
right.
the population of our country has. So from that point of view, we have not been able to overcome this challenge. So there may be concentration of these social groups in certain kinds of institutions, certain kinds of programs. If you go to elite institutions, their representations may be low.
Right.
So is the case with gender. Amongst minorities, I think the Muslim minorities case that they are represented to the extent much lower than the national average. So this is a second challenge. Earlier, these challenges were on account of historical deprivation, certain barriers that these groups faced. Today we are finding a new kind of challenge, and that challenge is that of affording, being able to afford higher education.
Absolutely.
Because of the increasing privatization and the full cost recovery and the cost of higher education going up. So that's a challenge. And the third challenge, which is very, very critical, that if you expand your higher education system, you create all the capacity that you need. If you are also able to provide it on the equitable basis, but if higher education is not of quality, then perhaps the whole purpose is defeated. So the third challenge is ensuring quality and promoting excellence in higher education. Earlier about excellence, the challenge was that within our country, how good we are. But today, our comparison benchmarks have become global. So it is not only sufficient to be good within your own country, within your own state, within your own country, but it's expected that you become
a global standard,
comparable with the best in the world. So these are the three challenges that I see in higher education.
Now, I don't want to extend this because these are three broad challenges. Almost you covered everything. And apart from that, there are two, three angles which you raised is the social inclusivity, inclusiveness in the education sector, contribution and participation of the socially backward classes and groups. What are the policies, what kind of innovative policy solutions in this current format that we have in the education system we can adopt to solve them?
I think it will have to be in a holistic manner. For example, I would say that this expansion, equity and excellence, these three things are interrelated.
Right.
So any policy that we adopt has to address these three things together, simultaneously.
Right.
Therefore, the way I see it is that these expansion, equity and excellence are like triple helix, which defines the gene of higher education. So sometimes we hear that, okay, we have compromises, we have compromised quality because of the quantity.
Right.
We have not been able to attain excellence because of the equity. I do not think, or at least the evidences that we have based on how other countries in the world have grown, that all of these three things will have to be addressed simultaneously. Now, at the same time, it is also important that since quality and excellence is focus, therefore, we should try to improve the quality of, by and large, all kinds of higher educational institution.
Right.
But those who have attained certain level of quality, they need to be further encouraged to become excellent. So this will have to be there. And a number of steps have been taken in these directions.
So one big, many experts say that in last 40 years, not enough investment has been made in the higher education. Not comparing the size of the population that we have and the international standard. For example, if you see the contribution of GDP or budget allocation in the education, that has remained within 2 to 3%. So this argument, how far you agree, and what extent of activities or work is left?
I fully agree with this argument that presently one of the reasons of lower quality, not being able to attain global level of excellence, and also not being fully equitable, is because of the underinvestment in higher education. Way back in 68, as people are all familiar, and that number is cited, that the Radhakrishnan, the Kothari Commission had suggested that we should be investing 6% of our GDP on
education.
Education. Today, that number is around 4%, even after so many decades. We thought that, okay, by creating an enabling condition whereby the private investment in education could come, we should be able to mitigate this gap. Lately, over the past three decades, we have seen large number of private universities, private colleges, self-financed colleges, they have all come up.
Right.
Some of them are good, but by and large, on an average, their quality is still not as good as we would be expecting. And then they are also leading to another barrier, as I was just saying, that the affordability barrier for the meritorious people belonging to poorer section of the society or deprived section of the society.
Right.
So all said and done, the public investment in higher education has to be increased. Kothari Commission had also suggested that primary, secondary and tertiary education, they are all equally important. Therefore, 2% of the GDP on each of these,
that's very fair,
should be, and that is a very fair assessment. From that point of view, in higher education, we are spending close to 1% today. Mm-hmm. So that investment in higher education has to be doubled. Having said this, that if we increase the investment in higher education, will it automatically ensure quality?
That's it.
Perhaps not. But this will at least create a necessary conditions for the rest of the things to be followed.
Right.
In addition to investment, there are certain other things. For example, the governance, the quality of the faculty, the commitments, the leadership, the decision-making processes.
Right.
All of these will also have to be addressed in order to make best possible use. But these will not be possible unless we make investment in
necessary investment proposals. Now, sir, there are two major issues we also find is a big challenge for the higher education sector. One is infrastructure, which we discussed indirectly in the thing. The second is quality of teaching, which can be massively improved. So, in one hand, you said that we have enough. So I am mixing two, three issues together so that you give your broad views on this. So in one hand, we are lacking, we have scope for potential scope to investment in infrastructure and quality of teaching. On the other hand, we saw recently that 60-70% of the engineering graduates that are coming up from the private sector, universities or colleges, mushrooming, which are mushrooming across the country, are not employable. A large section of them are not employable. Thirdly, this ruling government has given excessive focus to skill development in the form of education. Now, skill development is a part which is part of, I think, lower education, middle education, also the higher education. Now, how are they, all these policies being made by this government and this real challenge is coming? Are we setting the priority, education priorities right at the policy making level?
I think you have asked many questions. First question is that yes, because of the resources, because of the underinvestments, there are many factors which are affecting the quality. And therefore the quality need to be improved, need to be increased. As regards the surveys of various agencies saying that how many graduates are unemployable, I have a slightly different take.
Okay.
Yes, it is true that there is a graduate unemployment in our country.
Mm-hmm.
There is a long gestation period after graduation and before they get jobs.
Right.
Sometimes people remain unemployed. So it's a reality that there is a graduate unemployment. This could be because the quality of the graduates is low, and therefore the industry is not finding it usable, employable. But there is also a factor that given the size of the graduates which are being produced in our country, the economy is not creating enough jobs. Presently the scenario is that I am not willing to accept all the blames of unemployability on the education sector. Yes, quality needs to be improved. Quality makes the graduates better employable. But at the same time, the economy should also
flourish,
grow in such a manner that it creates jobs. Why I say so? That quite often those people who are not able to get jobs.
It's a very good argument actually. That it is not about the jobs. It's not about the scalability or employability.
No, what I'm saying is that yes, I mean people could remain unemployed or is termed as unemployable because they lack certain quality.
Naturally.
For that, the educational institution must focus.
Right.
They must try to make their curricula in sync with the industry requirements and so on and so forth.
Right.
Should improve their pedagogy, should improve their quality. I'm not denying this. But at the same time, it is also possible that we are producing almost 3.6 million enrollment means you divide it one third, one fourth. That is the graduates which are being produced,
right.
9 million at least, 9 to 10 million every year. So if the economy is not creating as many jobs, so these people, irrespective of their quality, would remain unemployable.
Right.
So I think that has to be looked there. Why I say so is that quite often, when people are not finding jobs, they go abroad.
Right.
They find jobs. They are often valued for their knowledge, for their skills, etc. And so on and so forth. So it has to be addressed at both the front.
Right.
As regards skilling, the question that you asked, yes, skilling is needed. But as you were hinting, skilling has many dimensions. At one level, there are need for skilled manpower across a large number of sectors. So e-commerce is flourishing, you need delivery boys, so you need people who have the skill to drive motorbikes and so on, so we need skills on that. We need carpenters, we need electrician, we need plumber, all of these things are needed. For those kinds of skills, the higher educational institutions are not best suited to provide these skills. But at the same time, I would also say that those who are in higher education, those who are undergoing a degree program, we should know that what are the skills that these graduates require. For example, if somebody is doing, say, bachelor's in commerce, so you should know that a bachelor of commerce should have what kind of skills so that he could be employed as a bachelor of commerce in the economy. And therefore, the educational institution should focus on those areas. So if it is a bachelor's of engineering, of course, you don't expect a bachelor of engineering to become a carpenter or to become a technician or electrician.
Right.
But then you can find out that what are the kind of skills which a bachelor's in engineering is required to have in order to be acceptable. So higher educational institutions need to focus on them. So I would like to divide the skill development and the skilling into these two parts.
I see. So last question, just to conclude the interview, I want to ask, you know, taking this, is two, three questions I'll again put and your suggestions on that. Is privatization a solution in the process? What is the role that the Association of Indian Universities is playing to provide necessary policy suggestions, solutions to the policymakers, and also to the thousands of universities now today we have in this country?
I would say that now this debate of the public versus private is past.
Okay.
Is not as much relevant today. While I'll keep on emphasizing and insisting that it is the responsibility of the state to invest in the public sector.
Right.
But at the same time, we also cannot ignore fact that a predominant proportion of the higher educational institutions and enrollments are in the private sector. So I think our challenge is to work towards improving the quality of all higher educational institutions. So I can't say that focus only on improving the quality of the public universities. Right. Because I know that 60% of the enrollment in higher education is in the private sector. So our focus has to be improving the quality of both the public and the private sector.
Right. Absolutely.
Now the challenges and the issues to be addressed at the public and the private universities may be different.
Different.
Public universities may be suffering because of the underinvestments. Mm. Private universities might be suffering because of the excessive regulations. Mm. So I think we need to create enabling framework to ensure that overall quality of the higher educational institutions are improved. I have been saying, and a few others also share my ideas and thoughts, that it's important to have institutions of excellence. Mm. But a country of our size, of our diversity, a few islands of excellence in the sea of mediocrity would not work. So I think taking the education and educational institutions across the board.
I mean, we yet not have a Harvard or a Oxford in India. I mean, we are dreaming that. We thought of Nalanda University to be that. But we're still dreaming. There is no one university in top 100 or 200 global universities.
As yet, no.
Right.
But I think during the past 5-7 years, at least the Indian universities are exposing their data. Now, if you make a list of top 1,000 universities in the country, there are sufficient number of institutions coming in.
Right.
But amongst the top 200, by one global ranking, one or two institutions are appearing. Amongst top 300, a few more are. If you go amongst top 500, then the number is presently around some 40 or something. So that number is peaking, but we are still far, far behind them. But then, as I said, we should aspire to become globally excellent, but only a very small number of best and excellent institutions will not serve our purpose. Our purpose would be served when the overall quality of higher education is improved.
So you heard that there are certain ways we can address India's challenges in higher education. So thank you so much, and keep watching the Policy Times.